Hello, loved ones. Welcome to the Whose Life Is It Anyway podcast. We made this for you who are now ready to help create a world that works for everyone. Enjoy.
Hello, everybody. Today we're talking to Ranbir Puar, and we are very, very excited to see her again. You are a life strategies coach, author, and speaker, and you have an app out with a meditation that's been downloaded several million times, as far as we know. Is that true?
Yes and no. No. So I'm on Insight Timer, which has about 18 million users a month, and I have some guided visualizations there.
As one of the top, like the staff pick several
times. Yeah, I've been a staff pick 20 times there.
Yeah.
And I'm building an app based on some content of mine. So we're just in the testing phase of the app, which is reaching about 30 million people. The content has reached about 30 million people this past year. So that app is in testing. So I'm pretty excited.
That's crazy.
So you're helping a lot of people.
It's pretty wild to think, you know, you can go from feeling like nothing to creating value in the world, you know, in your life cycle. Yeah. So it's quite, if I can do something like that, anybody can do it, is how I feel. But it's life strategies that I created that have just been resonating with people. And so the traffic in and around those has been wonderful.
And that ties in really well with the theme of this whole summit, like whose life is it anyway? So You are working with life strategies. How does that work?
Well, you know, I think it started, you know, we teach what we need to learn. I think that I suffered from a really low self-image growing up. I struggled through different types of abuse, which led me into falling into that wonderful story of the victim. It's so enticing, you know, and it's just like, here, I'm here for you always. And so coming into a place where you look at that and think, that victim story, yes, it serves the program that I experienced, but it doesn't serve me, and it's my life anyway, right? So yeah, exactly. Trying to be able to shed the story of the victim and the inner critic, and trying to awaken my inner champion that knows the way for me, and understanding my path may be different than the people I grew up with or the people I'm surrounded by, but what is my unique voice and how can I create value for myself first and foremost and my family, and then inching out from there to the world.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work. Awakening your inner champion. How is that done?
Well, I have a free 10-day course to teach some steps on it, but a lot of it has to do with auditing and honesty and really being able to catch your own thoughts. You know, I think Louise Hay said it's difficult because they move so quickly. And so being able to harness that real desire to be fully and completely accountable to yourself. Mm. You know, we come into this world alone, we leave this world alone. So why is it in our Western world and culture we take the idea of being alone as some sort of punishment? Whereas in the East, it's the greatest act of self-love.
Mm.
And so blending my ancestral practices with the conditioning of where I live, trying to find my way back to being okay with being alone and accountable and finding that beauty and uncovering my life.
But it's also a big thing moving from victimhood to accountability. That's it.
Oh, it's huge. Yeah. And you have to break it up into small steps. We didn't get there in one step. So, you know, might have taken 100. So you take 100 to get out. And I think that's the challenge, because we live in this world of instant gratification. Reply to my text, like my photo, love my video, comment. You know, all of that allows us to fall into that trap of victimhood. and a trap of trying to think your life belongs to somebody else, and it sure doesn't, as you know from all the work you're doing on your summit. You know, your whole purpose is to try to get people to let go of that and to go for that long-term satisfaction. One of the quotes that resonates for me a lot in this category of transforming from victim to victor is a Diane Ackerman quote. It says, when I get to the end of my life, I want to have lived the width of it, not just the length of it. And so my thing I say to people is go wide.
Yeah.
Don't rush through the pain.
Use the whole stage, right? Use the whole stage.
Yeah. I get goosebumps when I think about it. Go wide.
Yeah.
You're suffering. Like I was telling you before the interview, our 12-year-old family dog passed away. Yeah. And my heart feels so heavy.
Yeah.
And you physically feel it. So instead of saying, I want to rush through this, I'm thinking I'm going to go wide and allow myself to suffer.
Yeah.
Because it's real.
Yeah.
Whereas I think we're conditioned to hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Don't suffer. Oh, one of my clients, her partner, husband was about to pass away. And, and the doctor's like, oh, here, take this medicine. It'll make it better. And I said, no medicine is going to make that loss feel better.
No.
That's crazy.
Right. Why numb
when
you should feel?
Yeah.
So I think part of that transition is going wide and stop trying to numb your emotions, because that's where the growth lies. That's where the transformation lies. That's where the victim to victor story happens.
Yeah. Also, as like when you say you go wide, if you like become completely focused in the feeling, you sort of drown in it. But if you allow yourself to feel the full expansion and actually go a bit further than the feeling of itself, then you can contain it instead of it overflowing.
Yeah.
And that allows you to be present with the feeling without it just taking you completely over. So I usually say, don't move into the feeling. So like you can hold the feeling.
Yeah.
And contain. So when you go wide, like you say, that's.
On the other part of that, to add on to that is when you do go wide, you understand you're more than just that one feeling.
Exactly.
Right. If you try to focus just on the grief, then you feel like you're becoming grief. When really in my day, there's the beauty of the sparkle of my eyes and my children or my husband.
Yeah.
Or
it's
all of that. So going wide allows me to see all aspects of my life in while I grieve.
Yeah. So you can be happy even though you're in grief.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So just a current example of something, that I'm going through right now.
Yeah.
And we grieve in different ways, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a lot of grief going on right now too, like with everything that's going on, lost relationships, but like a relationship with a dog that's extremely personal on that level. But there's so much that going on so many levels right now. We are all dealing with grief, I think, on some level. So
for sure. And I think one of the biggest lessons I've learned about grief, because we've had a lot of loss in our lives, unfortunately, is that is understanding it as a mind habit and going to shifting the habit slowly. So, when my mom first passed away, I used to call her when I was cooking dinner. So that habit was very difficult to break. So I would call my older sisters during that time in order to help shift the habitual response a little bit, to help ease the grief a little bit.
Yeah.
And then obviously meditation and all those things help, because you feel like you're connected to them in a bigger spiritual way.
Yeah.
What has been your process of moving from that victimhood to this champion? Is there one practice that has been the biggest for you, or is it an amalgamation of many things?
I think it's an amalgamation, because realistically there's no one pill wonder for anything. So I think what it was removing the next big block. Like I would remove the first biggest obstacle, then the next, and then the next, and then the next. But one obstacle at a time. So one mind habit at a time. So if I had a mind habit of feeling as if, you know, shame was a big thing for me to work through, and, you know, in the level of consciousness, shame is the lowest feeling you can feel about yourself. And so understanding is that shame I feel, is that something that's real and happening to me in this moment? Or is this something in the past? So really breaking down step by step. And that's why I think I did the free course as 10 techniques. So just 10 different ways where you can apply one idea at a time. Because the victim says, look, I tried it and it didn't work, because you tried 10 things at one time. And so the victor says, actually become the master of one and then go to the next, but don't even think about starting the next until the first is done. And the main priority is always the primal need, sleep, nourishment, and movement. And when you start taking care of yourself on the primal level, all of the perceived needs fall into place because your brain trusts you. Because it knows you're following through on the basics. If you don't follow through on the basics, what's the point of all this up here? Because there isn't self-trust. So self-trust is a big part of the process.
It's like our Kung Fu master, he always says, like you have to work on the basics, and you keep working on that forever, like for your whole life. That's what you do.
No matter how high level you get. You always start with the basics.
And I saw, I saw something interesting by Warren Buffett yesterday. And I'm usually not into finances at all, but he had had somebody write down 25 life goals. And out of those 25, he had him circle the five most important ones. And then he said, after he had, the guy had had done that, he said, the other 20, if you work on those, you are hindering your mastery of those five. So those other 20 goals that you have as life goals, you should put them completely aside, because they will hinder those five. So when you've done those five, then you can start working on the other ones, because you become too thinly spread if you don't like hone in on doing one thing.
That's what the inner critic says, dilute, dilute, dilute. So then you, your story, your outcome matches the story you tell yourself that you're no good. But if you focus on one thing, you know, and I always say, you know, just focus on the next day. If you want to focus on, you know, maybe your nutrition or your exercise, just plan what you're going to do the next day. When we look the week out, when we're trying to change a habit, man, there's an excuse to give up right away. But if you just say, tomorrow I'm going to walk for 30 minutes, and that's your only thing. And then when you do that, then you can plan the day after that and the day after that. And then we build momentum and the snowball starts to go. But it's that big plan that screws us up.
I'm just thinking about my own life here. All the times that I just gave up.
Because we're asking too much of a strained brain.
But I think I'm repeating myself all through these interviews, because I'm saying this, we don't know how this machine works and we need to figure it out. Because we're scolding ourselves because we think we're stupid. But when just not using this correctly, we do not understand it.
We don't know its power.
So when we... when we are stressed out and we are yelling at our children, we cannot do it better than that, because that's how the brain works. So you do not have access to the parts of your brain where you're calm and you can say, I see you, I get this, let's just sit here for a moment. It takes a lot of the brain. You cannot.
So you have to, like you say, like focus on your own stuff and don't go into, like, it's okay to notice that you have this feeling of shame, but don't become the shame and don't
And don't use that as an excuse to self-sabotage.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. But so many of the things like the victimhood and the shame and the anger towards oneself for then not doing it and all these things, they're internalized things from the outside. Like we have seen our mother, father, something, not to blame them, but we have internalized something we have interpreted from the outside world and then put it upon ourselves. So seeing those things and loving those parts of ourselves and accepting them, and then you can let them go when you have expanded enough to be able to not be completely stuck in that emotion. Yeah, yeah.
And first you have to get the machine to work by breathing and get your sleep and rest and get
those primal needs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just, you know, and I think for me, the idea is, I think the most critical sort of factor is that self-trust and self-like. You know, I say this all the time, learn to like yourself is what I can help you do, because, you know, we all love a lot of people and we don't like them.
Yeah.
There's a lot of that goes on in, you know, in families and, you know, so on and so forth. So why focus so much on love? Why not start to focus on liking yourself?
Yeah.
And when you like yourself, you can trust yourself, and then your machine can work for you because you trust it. You know, think of how you treat people you like. You show up as your best self.
Yeah.
Don't always do that for people that we love.
No.
That's true.
No.
Hmm.
So that's sort of my tagline: learn to like yourself, learn to like your family, because it's so much more productive and fulfilling than the, you know.
That's so difficult, though. Jesus.
Yeah, but if you start with that as your goal,
yeah,
rather than this elusive self-love goal, you start with a self-like goal, then you will work towards treating yourself with kindness and respect. I often use the old Sufi saying, you know, it's supposed to be between you and other people, but when you speak to yourself, ask yourself, let your words pass through these three gates. Is it true? Is it kind? Is it necessary?
Yeah.
Well, what does that matter if you're communicating with other people, if the dialogue inside isn't true, kind, or necessary?
Yeah.
And so it's a good little tool to use towards self-like is, you know, is the dialogue I have with myself true, kind, and necessary?
Yeah.
Because we say a lot of unnecessary things to ourselves, you know, and if we audit it and be mindful of it, it can transform.
Yeah. That takes a lot of paying attention though.
Which is the ultimate goal, being present.
Yeah.
Get the most out of life that way.
Yeah. But that's all transformation takes, that presence.
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you can become present in so many ways. Like a technique I use is just to get people fully out of breath. So they have to focus on their breathing because, you know, so just
have them running around or what?
What I use is actually jumping jacks because it does a number of things. I've used them for 12 years. Especially with kids, is it makes their bodies bigger. So you can't get me in the full feet camera here. Mm-hmm. So we are in the star position. One of my visualizations is called the sun visualization, and referencing kids to be like a star. I'm like, oh, got stars up there too. And so it physically makes you bigger. So physiologically, your brain is getting signals that you feel confident.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you're doing the jumping jack, they're not easy. So you end up having to focus on your breath, and it boom, brings you in the present moment.
That's
so fun. It's my, you know, free anti-anxiety medicine right there. It really shakes you up so quickly, helps you focus on that breath, and it's free.
That's a good idea.
That's a really good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. And for people that can't jump, I just have them kind of try to run on the spot, but move their arms up higher, because the physiology part is a big deal, like making yourself bigger.
Yeah.
So it's not just the jumping jack and breath. It's the, holy, shoulders are back. You know, I'm bigger than I think I am. And we all are so much bigger than we think we are.
Yeah.
That's the truth. It's amazing. Like all these things, like many of them, all of us, we instinctively know so many things.
It's so good many. For us.
Why don't we do them?
Because of the program. The program. And then the program is so big and complex that we don't we get stuck. So that's why working in those, you know, 24-hour sort of compartments tends to be the best way to create the crack. We just need a little crack to get in, let the light, you know, in. And then from there, you start to see shift and change happen. But it has to be in those small increments.
Yeah. Digestible bits.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah. So now people are going to go visit your site and they're going to sign up for those 10 days to awaken their inner champion.
Yeah.
And then what happens after the 10 days with them?
Well, in that program, I created it as my gift and my thank you because I created that after a prayer was answered for somebody I care for deeply. And once his health was safe, I said, I'm going to do something to say thank you. So it includes a free half hour consult with me. And from wow. there, we can decide which, is quite time consuming, but it's something I've included, and I would like to leave it there until I can maybe move towards a group call eventually, which will start to happen. But for now, I can still manage it. And so that is included there. And then we can talk about one-on-one coaching, and we're going to be developing group programs soon as well. So I do run them here, like groups, you know, once a year for a shorter period of time, but I guess the evolution is to go to the larger groups.
That's eventually. What happens when people's time, like when there's no more hours in the day, then you have to do that.
Yeah. And I actually didn't think I would enjoy group classes because, you know, I'm so focused and hyper-focused on the person I'm with in the moment, but they have been so incredible and so valuable in being able to create community and connection and people feeling safety and knowing others are going through what they're going through.
Yeah.
Normalizing it has been huge.
Yeah, exactly.
So it was a surprise to me too. I actually didn't know if I'd like it, but as the leader of the group, I didn't know. And as it unfolded, it just has always been such a beautiful process.
Yeah. It still amazes me that people think that their inner monologue is unique.
Yeah.
It's the same thoughts we have. It's the same sentences. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're telling ourselves
it's amazing, like how pervasive the programming is, that it's in everyone, and at the same time we can think it's unique to us, like we are how many billion people by now. And we think
that's why I say the self-image is something that people struggle with. It's the foundation of the human experience. Every single one of us has an inner dialogue. Every single one of us is trying to ping off other people. It doesn't matter whether you're I was born in a village in India, believe it or not, and we moved to Canada, but like whether I had lived there, I would still have the same pinging that I do here in Canada. So it's something we all have in common. So you're absolutely 100% right there.
Hey, thanks for watching. If you liked what you just saw, head on over to whoselifeisitsummit.com/podcast, where you can find full-length episodes as well as an audio format. And we do a lot of other cool stuff. You can hang out with us and other like-minded individuals who want to create a world that works for everyone. And we do that on our platform where we can chat and we have Q&As and exclusive interviews as well. So there's so much to get over there. So come on over and play with us.